Okay, welcome back. Sensei Kerry again, helping me out on these videos. We've been asked to go through the Pinan katas. So basically, I apologize if you're not sort of Wado-based kata, but just try and enjoy them. Next thing I'd like to say is don't use these as examples for your grading, because your association might do things slightly different from the association that I belong to. So always respect your sensei. If they mention a comment that you're doing this kata and certain areas might be contradicting what they do, then pay respect to them and do it their way. Yeah. So these Pinan katas are basically around what I've learned with different instructors. And also I'm finding the rationale between lots of the techniques and the directions and the combinations. Because some of the orthodox movements, or the reasons for those movements, I'm sorry to say, but sometimes they contradict each other, or they don't quite work for me. For me, I have to stress that, for me. So every time I do a kata, I have to try and break it down, and maybe the uki comes in from a slightly direction, or a Mawati Ginambarai, it's not somebody attacking you from the back. So bear with me, if you want to carry on with those traditional thoughts, then fine. It will not alter the look or the effect of the kata. Kata is sacrosanct, that's not changed. The other thing with the way I do my katas is I will always try and do a little bit of a jiu-jitsu move with them, because that sort of accentuates the timing of your turn and the way that your wrists are moving and the way that your body should be moving. So there's a combination of things, and then there's a lot of people who take small pieces of kata and they use them for fighting techniques. They'll have a variation of the kata in one specific area. So kata is a personal thing. Learn the pattern, but make it your own. And you can always tell people who think about their kata and try and put meaning behind it, because you can see it in their eyes, you can see it in the way their body moves. It becomes a live kata, not a dead kata, not just a dance. Okay, see where it takes us. Okay, so the association that I belong to, and I'm sure it would be the same with lots of the Wado-based groups out there, we always do a kion kata, which is a very basic one for lower Q grades, maybe just before their grading, or just to get them in the theme of moving in different directions, but keeping it very, very basic. And the next one we do is Pinan Nidan. Now, Pinan Nidan, actually, ni means two. So we do katas 2, 1, 3, 4, 5. I don't know the history about that, but the way that it's been explained to me is that Pinan Shodan, it's got a Maigeri in it, it's got Shutos. So those are most really slightly more complex for somebody maybe taking their yellow or orange belt. So that's why you do it in the order of 2, 1, 3, 4, 5. So Pinan Nidan. Pinan Nidan. Hey! Pinan Nidan. You need to take away trying to have good zenkutsu stance, good junzuki stance, good shikidachi or kibidachi stance, good neko stance. Your instructors will point you in the direction for those. also transferring from one stance to another stance. So if you have your junzuki stance and you are going to transition into your cat stance, making sure you've turned this foot and it's not sticking out here because you're going to damage your knee. So the transition from one stance to another is important. It plays a big role when you start to do your free fighting. You should be able to move directions, keep your stance, being able to move in any direction, not slipping over or falling over, or keeping your composition, your composure. Your brain should be in control, not your body. So that means you have to keep control of your kata. Once you've got your mind and your body working together, that's brilliant. I'm sure there's a program, martial arts program, about mind and body. So worth a look. Also, when you're doing Muay Thai, try not to take your foot across and then turn. Try and make sure it's the whole of the body that's turning, because then you'll be able to stop. You will have your balance all the way through the turn. You could have put your foot anywhere. You could have ended up in the wrong stance. If you're using it with your body, you can finish exactly where you want to and be in the right stance. Also, I've seen so many people, when they come to do the Muay Tigiranbarai, watch the back heel. That means I've gone this way. Need to be going away from the attacker. So if you're checking some things on your Pinan Kata, check you're not lifting that heel up. Thank you. Okay, I'd like to talk about those moves. So, see so many people, very short, cat stance, hands are here. Really, if you're doing a nuki here, it's too late, they've already hit you. So, longer cat stance. Cat stance is a variation of your shito. It's just pulled in by the same amount. So it's a lot longer than you think. Not here, with your backside sticking out. But here. Okay, Sensei. So you can put it into a fundamental move. So, change, punch, step. So you need to use this as take, then through. Not really a big strong believer in nuktai, so you could change it to a fist or even take the body with it, redirecting in asu. So turn, grab, step back here. Use your hip and your body. Just pull in, but hip to pull. And then the same when you come over here. Use punch. Use so use a combination of inasu and entering, irimi. And also grab, coming over the top. Not just your hands moving, but the whole body. push. So I'd like to talk about directions. Both Takamizawa Sensei and Schmidt Sensei, who I've had privilege to train with over the years, direction should be 360 degrees all the way around, and up and down. So Takamizawa Sensei actually come up with a numbering system. So when he was teaching you a kata, he would only have to say a number. You don't have to learn this, but this was the thought process. Odd numbers were with your left hand, even numbers with your right. So direction one, direction two, direction three, direction four, direction five, direction six, direction seven, direction eight. There's also direction nine and 10, which when he said that, I'd never thought about it before in kata. But when you do Pinan Godan, you jump and land, yeah, dropping, ducking down, kushunku, where you're coming underneath. So it's quite interesting when he did come up with those numbers. So those, you know, other people out there who had the privilege to train with Takamizawa Sensei, especially down at Temple, I'm sure that's brought some memories back. Try and think of every direction when you are doing your kata. So you're the center of the universe. It doesn't mean that they're in these directions. They can be any variation between there. But you really need to stick to the pattern and direction of the kata. Yeah. He also used another word, which was called distant. DI, direction. ST, stances. N, numbers, the ones that I've just talked to you about, and others. And others' numbers. I'm sure he was the first karate computer instructor that came out. And direction, stances, numbers, and timing. Timing of your technique, timing of your stepping. Yeah. So when you come to do your grading, as I say, don't particularly use this as a grading purpose, but when you do your grading, don't rush it. Don't rush the kata. You need to show that you fully understand the kata. You can change direction from one stance to another stance, to a slightly different stance, that's if it's called, maybe a zenkutsu dachi to kiba dachi or shiki dachi. Yeah, you should be able to go from one to the other. I try and speed up my turns, because that's the time when you show that you've got good balance, good timing. But don't rush the kata. You need to show that you're confident and you fully understand the kata. Don't rush it. How many of you have seen people? They go, hell for leather. And what have they done? They've stumbled over themselves. They're all out of balance. Punches and kicks are going everywhere. So please show the people who are grading you that you know exactly what you are doing. And don't get carried away with the other people who are taking their grading. They might all off over the place. You try and keep your own timing. If you make a mistake, because you've got that timing and because you've taken your time, you'll be able to pick the kata up from where you made that mistake and then carry on. Again, made a mistake, but you knew where you were in that kata. So it might be very simple going into the yoi stance, going to yoi rather, but I see so many people, especially in Wado, you know, stance is too wide and this is too stiff. It should be quietly confident, not making a big exhibition out of just going into yoi. So your width of your yoi stance is important. Sensei, can I borrow you? And the way to check it is if you go yoi, but go wide, that's fine. So if you get next to somebody as the stance is too wide, just put your hand against their chest. Okay, now if you take it, yeah, it should be a fist and maybe, sorry, a foot, maybe one and a half fists. It's narrower than you think. Some of you think you've got massive shoulders, yeah, or massive hips, but then try exactly the same thing where you put and put pressure on it. And there is a remarkable difference. So narrow or correct, yeah, as opposed to, this looks very impressive, but you're too stiff, stance is too wide. So just be quietly confident when you go into your ready stance. Thank you. Okay, when I start doing practicing kata, I never try and deviate from the kata itself. Again, when I see people do kaisetsu or bunkai, they see a move and they sort of make up almost another kata until it doesn't resemble the kata itself. But when I start doing a kata, I try and think about the orthodox way of thinking about the kata. So, Sensei, can you come back? They're very subtle differences. So the traditional thought is fighting stance is they're coming exactly 90 degrees. Well, why would they come in 90 degrees when I've got my arm in the way? There's no, your body's not, it's not, I'm not standing there. Next thing is, okay, it can be coming forward and punching Jodan because that's the only place that's available. And the next thing is my hand goes up. Okay, yes. But when you come to step and punch, you're actually on a different center line. The kata is not this. Same again, Sensei. Up, down, and I step across to punch Chudan. So this is where I'd need to be to actually punch, to do a zuki. But the kata is using your zenkutsu, your junzuki stance. So it means you're further over. So the only way that that can work is if the attacker moves around slightly, a little bit too much. But it should work up to X amount of degrees. When you're thinking about kata, you should think about lots of directions, and I'll come back to that in a sec. So here, they can see this direction. Okay, so one. Now when I go to punch, I'm on exactly the correct center line. So just by the uki moving around slightly, yeah, it makes sense of the direction. And the direction of the punch, the stance. So that fits into the kata by just moving the uki around slightly. This technique, shouldn't be hitting. It should be with your body weight dropping. So I'm putting no effort in hitting. Sorry about this. No, no. So should be just relaxed and let your arm drop. And your arm drop with your body weight. So, try and think of this dropping. Okay. Next orthodox is, can you come here? Way of thinking is for a maigeri coming behind and you turn in and trying to block. I don't know about you, but I wouldn't turn if somebody was kicking behind me. You know, I would be moving away from the kick. So, in my thinking, they've already started at this angle. So one, two. When they do the maigeri, I'm not only moving away, but I've just done my gidanbare. So instead of thinking somebody's behind you, turning and blocking here, really it should be a continuation from this uki. Yeah, very slight angle. One, two, three. In fact, I don't even have to make contact. It's just a covering, and my toe sabaki as I'm turning. So the next, 1, 2, 3. So the kick has gone through, he carries on through, 1, 2, 3. Comes jodan, chudan, and then punch. So this is an example of my thoughts about this pinan. If you want to use the orthodox way of thinking about it, that's fine. It does not alter the pattern and the way that you do your techniques in Pinan Nidan. But to me, it makes more sense. And if it makes more sense to me, then I have passion about the kata. Not just doing a dance routine. So the next way of looking at Pinan Nidan is from a jiu-jitsu way. So if you're here, so again, so I drop, not lift, I start to drop. This one's out. This one. Takes out. Now, Sensei Kerry tries to go through, step forward and round, and grabs again. I'll just let this hand relax out the way so as you can see more of what's happening here. A lot of people, when they just drop your hands, Sensei, a lot of people do this when they do Ginanbare. So here, let your body come back, let your elbow come in, let your wrist turn. Back, back, back. Turn, 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 down. When they're down, then you come up. Then you draw down the center line to punch. So we'll try and put all that together. Not here. Going back here. So if you put your jiu-jitsu moves into your pinan moves, it tells you how much body movement you need or how much elbow you need to move, wrist action. So if you do it from the beginning, from here. One, two, carry on, round, grab, down, up, down, and punch. Do it from here. Not lift, drop, grab, back. So, might be a mixture of thoughts, but the more reasoning you put behind those, it's your kata. It's your movements. It's not somebody else's. But obviously you have to be well-versed with the kata before you start experimenting. And don't forget, if your instructor doesn't like those ideas, then not a problem, you stick to what he or she, her thoughts. Thank you. So Pinan katas, I'm not really a very good historian about karate or judo or any sort of martial arts. Some of my colleagues here are far, far more specific in that than than myself. But basically, your pinans, the way that I look at it, and I'm sure I've been told it before by my instructors, is that your pinan katas, it's like a breakdown of kushanku. So I'm sure when you've gone through kushanku, you'll have certain moves. You think, pinan yonda, pinan nidan. Yeah, you have those light bulb moments. And that helps you to go through kushanku, because kushanku, as you know, it's a very long kata. So by breaking the kata down into five disciplines, maybe change them, and that's how the pinans came about. I'm sure there's some people out there who are watching this will get in touch and say, no, it's something else, which is great. It's an involvement. That's what we want, a discussion. Yeah. So where do we see this? Where we see these in the syllabus that we do, we see them in Ippon committees number 3 and number 4. So we've done a series on that. So if you want to look at them in depth, great. But just to jog your memories, I'll use Sensei here and just quickly go through them. So you can see the Jodanu because you can see the Gidambare. I've always been asked, why do we do 3 Jodanukas and why do we do 3 Gidambares? And I think if you did Wado-ryu about the same time as myself, which is when the world was sepia, then you remember Sanbongamitis. So it would be looking like this. So it'd be Junzuki Jodan, so you'd be going 1, 2, 3, 4. So Sanbongamitis, can't remember when they were changed to Ippongamitis, but that's the story. When you're doing the 3 attacks, I suppose the 3 attacks, I wish we had them these days, but I suppose Nihon committees have changed it, and Kions, because when you're doing the Junzuki and the Jodanuki, you had to do mai and m'ai all the way along. You had to adjust the distances. And that got you used to, with somebody attacking you and you correcting your distance, maybe on the second one or the third one, so that you're ready for the zuki. 1, 2, 3, bang. Yeah, same with the junzukis. So 3 junzukis, 3 jodanukis. Just think that they are sambongamitis. Your kiais on your last jodanuki. Your last jodanuki, your kiai. To me, that means that you would have attacked your raken. Maybe it's a potential. But when you actually see Ippon committee number 1, you know, there is a your raken after your jodanuki. So possibly, maybe that would have been in the kata. Don't know. But your kiai on your 3rd jodanuki. Don't forget it.
So in the previous series of partner work videos we've done, we've looked at the point from uke. Great. Sort of in-depth discussion on the, you know, what's going on within the wazas, but I've never seen anybody doing from uke's point of view before. So that was quite useful. That was a learning curve for all of us. What I want to do with this one is do the top takeaway points for each kata. What specifically is this kata trying to teach you that maybe other katas aren't? What makes it different from other katas? If you could encompass everything into one kata, you would only need one kata. But there are lots of katas, so hopefully there are lessons to be learned. And this is what we're trying to do with this series. What is it that makes this kata so useful, so specific, and what do we need to take away from it? These katas came from Okinawan karate. And part of the discussion we had was, well, what is it that makes the Wado version of this, an old Okinawan kata, Wado? I know Sensei covered this in the discussion and the demonstrations of using the jiu-jitsu. So rather than this being a striking blocking action, it's actually to remove a wrist lock. So it's a subtle shift. If you're watching this and you're a non-Wado practitioner, then maybe this is a blocking action. But if you're a Wado practitioner and you're thinking of it with your Wado hat on, then yes, this could quite conceivably be a wrist release. So it's something to have a little think about when you're performing, especially if you are Wado based, is what is the jiu-jitsu? Is it not just a block? Is it something else? Is it a wrist release? And Sensei also mentioned the sections with nukate. Are these strikes? Or are these using Wado principles like inasu or noru? Even kiri, are we cutting rather than striking? So this could possibly change your mindset and attitude and understanding of the kata if you're Wado based, if you start looking for these Wado style principles, more jiu-jitsu, more taisabaki and body evasion rather than direct confrontation and striking and blocking. So a useful tool if you're a Wado based practitioner. Go away and see if you can find what you think is the Wado within this kata. What we also want to touch on is the top takeaway points from the kata. We started with five, some katas maybe not so many, some maybe some more. But the top five for this one, the first real sort of kata, there is a more basic kata beforehand, but this is your first proper kata. And as Sensei mentioned, it's stances. You've got your zenkutsu, you've got your kiba dachi, you've got your neko ashi. So when you're practicing this, and especially as you start going up through the grades, then your katas need to start getting better. They need to be more accurate. In the transitions between katas, are you not lifting your heel? Are you maintaining your posture? If you're going to make a mawate, are you starting to lean forward? Or are you maintaining your posture through the movement? So these are the points, and video cameras, you know, most mobile phones now have a video camera. If you can video yourself performing your kata, it's horrendous, because you can see exactly what you're doing wrong when you think you're doing it perfectly right. So you can just set a video camera up at your home practice or in your dojo, have a little look, pay attention to your feet. Are your heels lifting? Are you maintaining your posture? Work on your stances, and hopefully that improvement will carry all the way through. I think there's a Pinan requirement for dan grades. So, you know, if you're taking your first dan, second dan, third dan, you know, and you're doing, asked to do Pinan Nidan, it needs to be a whole lot better than somebody doing it for yellow belts, orange belts. And video and this type of thing, but analysing your stances is a big thing. The second point is, again, since I mentioned this, is body drop. The first technique isn't just with the arm, it's the body dropping vertically down. I shall have probably a few good bruises tomorrow, because Sensei's got quite a lot of body to drop. And it's... he's been very rude over there off camera. The impact is huge. For him, it was no effort at all. He's not expending energy, muscular strength. It's just gravity doing its thing. So look for principles like this. Is there a body drop? Is the body shifting? Is the body turning and movement? Can you make your usage of your body as efficient and as productive as possible? The third sort of key point is muate. Since I went into great depths with this, heard it described as a controlled fall. So rather than the foot going round and the body turning, you shift your weight and then the foot comes round. So it's the body shift that's making the muay rather than the foot making a mechanical movement. And again, can you maintain your posture through the muay? And certainly some of these other turns, a bit more complicated. So again, video camera and video editing will be useful to look at your performance back and see how you're doing with that. Fourth key point is timing. You see, a lot of people, when they start, they don't understand the relationship between the foot landing and the punch finishing. You either see the foot land, then the punch finishes, or people sort of try punching too soon. So is your timing good? Is your timing accurate? The same applies to the Jodenukes. No point in creating all this energy moving forwards. If you stop, then perform your Jodenuke. The two need to be together. And don't rush. Don't rush. Try and make your techniques as clean as possible. But if you're feeling confident with them, maybe do your muay a little bit quicker, just to show off that you have been practicing your muay and you can turn and still maintain a good stance. But don't rush the rest of it. Demonstrate you understand the hip rotation, the stances, the timing. And the final key point is mai. Ma, ai. Ma, distance, timing. Ai, to harmonise. So if you're doing application work with a partner, are your distances correct for your attacks? Are your distances correct for your responses? Are you harmonising with them or are you fighting them? Especially with the jiu-jitsu style moves. If you try wrestling them, it's not going to work. So there needs to be this timing and distance, this moving from the centre to affect their stance, their balance. It's not a wrestling match. Get into a wrestling match, whoever's the heaviest and strongest is going to win. So five key points to take away from this. Stances, body drop, muay, timing, and mai. I say some of the other katas later in this series might have a couple more, some are a little bit less. But hopefully these will give you things to look at with your practice and maybe help you improve.
So if you are one of our regular viewers on YouTube, please let us know what you think, because without your comments, we wouldn't carry on, we wouldn't continue. We just carry on with our own training. We don't like the adverts on YouTube. We try and keep them away. Maybe some of our older stuff have got it on there. We just do it purely for our interest and all the things that we've learnt over the years. We don't want them to disappear. We want them recorded, whether they're right or whether they're wrong. But we enjoy ourselves, you know, through watching ourselves, we can see little mistakes as well. Some things we could have done better. Some things we would have done better when we were younger, if we'd have known all this stuff, but with Sensei Kerry's knees and my new hip, then, we could have done better when we was a lot younger, but if we'd have known all the things that we'd known now. So please put a yes or a no, or give us some comments, give us some feedback. Thank you very much.